Well, good afternoon, everyone. Let me add my words of welcome to Theo's. Thank you for your time. Much appreciate you, you coming out to listen to us today. I know we're already biting into the day pretty much, and I have a four-hour presentation that I've given, that I've given 30 minutes, or maybe even quicker. I wanted to give you some idea of the actual, some of the technical detail behind what we did, and maybe answer any questions that you might have on that as well. So we're saying this is towards a self-organized, self-managing cloud architecture. Hopefully that'll become a little bit clearer as we move on. I'll talk about the key concepts of the project itself, a little bit of the architecture overview, some of our simulation results, and then some concluding remarks. So the key concepts, I suppose, just to return, I wrote this when Theo was talking, because I wasn't sure whether he was going to show the last slide he showed. So this is the low-tech version of his nice circular diagram that he had. So I'm calling this basically the issues driving the research. This is the things that were in our head 3 years ago, when we were saying, you know, we'd like to do some of this research because we see issues with the cloud as it stands. So some of the things were the cost of centralized resource management, as I said, I wrote it a couple of minutes ago, centralized resource management, and that's not insignificant, especially as the cloud scales. Data centers are becoming bigger and bigger, and as they're becoming bigger and bigger, the idea of managing resources centrally is becoming more and more difficult. Finding the best place to put the next service in the cloud is becoming increasingly difficult as the cloud gets bigger. It's a very complex problem. So doing that centrally breaks down at a particular point. As Theo said, the current cloud is very low resource utilization, and that's down to sort of poor centralized management policies. Now, they're not all poor. They're more sophisticated, the policy finding the best place for the next task in the cloud. The more time you put into it, the more you'll come up with a better place, but then the longer it takes to actually place the service. So at times when the cloud is under pressure, there's a lot of requests coming in, you can see the resource manager reverting to a first fit approach. Wherever it'll fit, put it there, because we're interested in giving service to our end user. So these issues then could lead to low resource utilization. Again, over-provisioning also doesn't help that. High power consumption was one of the things that drove us from the beginning. And interestingly, from Theo's research, none of the providers were kind of worried about that, I suppose, because we're getting paid for our service, therefore we can pay for the electricity. However, the planet is suffering in a sense. The cloud is consuming about 3% of the world's energy production at the moment, and it's set to continue. That's a huge amount of energy. The rise of heterogeneous resources, these new accelerators that are coming online, and we predict that many more will come because they are energy efficient, they're faster, they're better, they're more accurate for true HPC applications. And they give us this sort of, this in into the HPC world as well, because HPC is what these things do well. So we wanted to make these exploitable, but when you introduce heterogeneous resources into a cloud, which traditionally has been homogeneous, so you have a cloud in which all the resources are the same kind, management of something that's all of the same kind is easy. You introduce different things, and then you have a different scale of management. To manage different things within a cloud, each of which are performing differently and behaving differently, evolving differently, has different cost factors, have different benefits, the management skyrockets. So then finding the best place within a heterogeneous environment at scale becomes very, very complex. Okay? So we see that these things are then, you know, putting more pressure on the centralized management system. And again, we still need scale. We want scale to drive efficiencies. You know, we want to have, at scale, we want to exploit the benefits of scale. You want to have very large data centers located near renewable energy sources where they can be easily cooled, for example, that type of thing. So there's a huge ecosystem here, and we said, you know, that's not hard enough. Let's try throw HPC into the mix as well, and we'll try and satisfy the HPC market. So you see, we were incredibly naive when we started off because we wanted to do everything. And to be fair, we did touch on a lot of these things in the solution that we actually provided. Another one of the things that we were interested in, I think, sort of as a something that we saw that was very important was to bring in this notion of a separation of concerns, where you have the users of the cloud and you've got the cloud service provider themselves. When you have heterogeneous resources in the cloud, they're typically can only be exploited by expert programmers, and typically they're offered to that expert programmer, at least they have at the start. This is changing now a little bit. As infrastructure as a service. So you go in there, you pay for the resource, you as the expert will go and configure the resource, set up your application, run your application, etc. And when you're doing that, you effectively buy the resource. The provider doesn't really care, he's getting his money. However, that resource is not necessarily being utilized efficiently. It depends on how good you are, you know, how much money you're willing to waste not doing things right. So by providing a separation of concerns, you'll see we wanted to separate the what should be done with from how it should be done. And then this whole idea of interoperability, again, is coming from this heterogeneity, and it also reaches out to the idea that we've got different clouds of different types, different management domains, but different management systems, and being able to work these things together. So we had a lot of things that were driving the research along the way. This idea of this heterogeneous cloud system. If you think about it for a moment, if you have, let's say, an environment in which you have a resource manager, let's call this one Mesos, and this one is OpenStack, and they're segregated in the sense that OpenStack is managing these resources. Here we can create virtual machines. Here we can typically create containers easily enough. If we want to create a service, a workflow, which combine these things, these containers and these VMs, well then, how do you do that? Well, if you go back maybe a year or two ago, then you have to be the expert. You've got to go in there, you've got to configure these things, you've got to use whatever interface you have to create your container, you've got to expose the ports, then here you create your virtual network interface, and then in your application you'll combine all those things together. That's not a simple thing to do. And if you can imagine, in doing that, you would have to reserve the hardware here, you have to reserve the hardware there, the utilization has gone down, the cost is going up. See, there's no real good exploitation of those resources. And in a cloud environment, you expect to be able to share efficiently and effectively among a huge user community, and if you've got that type of inefficiencies, you're not exploiting the hardware as it could be exploited. Okay, so that's kind of one of the things where we started up. Now, at the moment, this is a little bit nebulous because there are services out there like Amazon Web Services, which will give you not access to these accelerators as a kind of a platform as a service. So You can, for example, reserve a data flow engine within what the Cloud Lightning system is doing. Remember, we started 3 years ago. We're evolving that a lot faster. So our idea is that we wanted to create a service-oriented architecture for the emerging heterogeneous cloud. The customer focuses on what they want to do, and the provider focuses on how it should be done. Okay, so that was that's one perspective of our work. I could actually give this talk from about 10 different perspectives. And it would be 10 different talks really on what we've covered. But the perspective I take for this one is this separation of concerns, where we're trying to build this environment which helps us to do a certain number of things. So I try to indicate that here. So this Cloud Lightning box now, effectively, is that You know, is that question mark there, right? For here, what we're doing is we are creating a system which offers to the user, the end user, what we're calling a blueprint as a service, where the end user can create or can compose in a workflow manner a number of services, link them together, send them to this box, and this box will provision and connect the appropriate resources to efficiently service each of, or to proficiently run each of those services. And those services can be anything from, this could be a HPC application in itself. This could be some very, this could be some kind of visualization. It is a workflow of these services, the granularity of which is very fluid, okay? But typically we're thinking that the granularity, these services are very large grained. So these may even be parallel programs in themselves. And then that parallel program may need to be run on a cluster somewhere, etc. Okay, so you see, here we're offering this then as the service interface, not infrastructure as a service, because that would destroy our separation of concerns, but this blueprint as a service. There are some consequences to that, which I'll discuss in the next slide. But just I just keep it high level for the moment. So the second thing that this system does then is it manages heterogeneity at any scale. Now, Theo did say that we are concentrating at hyperscale. And indeed, at hyperscale, we get a lot of benefits from the actual management structure through the self-organization system that I'll introduce to you briefly in a moment. However, this system is capable of delivering benefits at any scale. And some of those benefits are not these improved utilization or reduced power, etc., but is the connectivity, is the fact that this system, and even at a small scale, our test bed is relatively small, will allow us to connect these heterogeneous resources, being managed by heterogeneous resource managers, creating heterogeneous resource abstractions, and putting all those things together in one place and managing them as a single workflow. So that's a benefit that's at the smaller scale that current clouds are beginning to move towards, but they don't have that type of detail that we can actually access here. In addition, our system can dynamically grow. We can dynamically attach new resources to our system. So as new accelerators become available, we effectively have a little bit of a plug and play interface, which will allow that piece of hardware to enter the system. It becomes associated with a particular resource manager. It has a telemetry endpoint, which allows us to look at how it's actually performing, and which helps us to decide on the health of the system. We don't use telemetry as the current cloud does for making decisions. We use telemetry to look back to see how is the cloud doing. Okay, I'll show you how we make decisions in a moment. If we were to use telemetry to make this to make decisions, we have this whole control flow, this control problem, because once you look at something, you say, well, what state is that in? Take the state in, make a decision, you go back, and the resource is in a different state because the loop is too big. Current clouds do that, right? So therefore, you might be making a decision to put a machine, to put a virtual machine on a piece, on a resource that 10 seconds ago was the best place, but now isn't, because something else happened somewhere else. Okay, these kind of things what kept us up at night, I guess. In addition, we could attach complete HPC machines themselves to this and use our system to deploy onto those machines. In the front of these machines, we have resource managers, the traditional Slurm, Rocks resource managers that you see, PBS, etc., that you see associated with these HPC environments. And this can then report through the telemetry system to here, say, what the capability is, what the capacity is, and then we can use that, again, from this orchestrator. And indeed, we can even connect different clouds together, or we can have services running in this cloud, and then mediated to services running in this cloud. So we have basically a general system for managing heterogeneity. And that's, I suppose, that's that. I was struggling to get that big picture for you, because I can give you a lot of detail, you kind of lose that. So that's what cloud lightning is. Now, what it has then, it has a dynamically expanding and contracting resource fabric. These things can come and can go. Typically, they'll just come. They'll only go if you're putting things down for maintenance, etc. There's a service model based on the application blueprints. So that's how we interface with our users. So and that drives separation of concerns. It has novel operational models and management strategies. And these are based on self-organization and self-management. I've already indicated that we think that centralized management is no good, particularly at scale, and particularly at scale in conjunction with heterogeneity. So what we did is we said, what we've got to do is we've got to devolve management decisions to parts of the cloud themselves. Those management decisions then are taken in throughout the cloud, and in some way we've got to bring those decisions together at So that we can make meta decisions. Okay. Again, I'll revisit this in a little bit. So we have a novel architecture based on self-organization and self-management, and the architecture is actually hierarchical because it allows us then to draw together these decisions at one particular point, which is the entry into the cloud. You'll see it in the next slide. So we use different types of resource abstraction methods transparently. So we can use containers, VMs. To manage different types of computational resources simultaneously, all in the same blueprint. We have co-allocation and co-management of heterogeneous resources supporting services within a single blueprint. So this single blueprint will come in, and this system will co-allocate and co-manage all of those resources necessary to serve that blueprint. And they'll do that according to a quality of service metric that we can have associated with the deployment. Again, this in some sense is technical, but in another sense it's very high level, because as I say, it's a 4-hour presentation otherwise. I'll skip over this because I more or less spoke about it. But what we do is we abstract the concept of a resource into what we call a CL resource. So this is an abstract concept which can be any of the underlying resources. It can be a physical FPGA accelerator, it can be a GPU, it can be a HPC machine, it could be a cluster running on a low latency network, it could be a VM, it could be a container. But to us, it's a resource with a particular characteristic, and because we're only dealing with one thing, we can manage that one thing very, very easily. So that's what we do, is we abstract away the concept of a resource. We have this plug and play mechanism. Again, the plug and play mechanism is designed so that when we add new hardware, as the hardware comes into the system, it registers with the system, I can do this, I'm of this kind. It comes to sit in the architecture. The management of that new hardware is associated with a specific place in the cloud that manages hardware of that type. And then it registers with a telemetry endpoint so that that manager can see how busy that thing is for making, I said it doesn't make decisions, but we do make low-level decisions at one point, but also for looking at the health of the cloud overall. There's a lot of details here that we'll skip over. Again, kind of a cartoon image now of what's happening here, which is, again, this pathway, but a little bit more exploded. So what we have here in the blueprint, we have different services. Again, the granularity of these can be pretty coarse. And we have a service catalog. With each of these service catalog, which, and these services are created by experts. So this could be a HPC machine, or HPC application. It could be a parallel application. It could require hundreds of cores, etc. It may even have a number of different implementations. It may have an implementation that runs only on CPUs. It may have an implementation that runs on CPUs and GPUs, for example. And with each of those, they'll have a different cost, a different quality of service, a different speed, etc. We represent that basically just as a vector of numbers that we can then use and to map onto what we call this quality of service requirement. So if a user says, I want this done as fast as possible, then that's a quality of service thing. It's pretty nebulous. However, we can use one of the elements of that vector to determine which of the implementations would be more appropriate to choose. in the gate. Thank you. I just needed a breath.
You've got multiple people that are saying that they want it all done as fast as possible. Then what do you do?
Then you pay. They pay, basically. So, and if we have, if everybody says, look, I want this done as fast as possible, I'm willing to pay for that, then you'll keep going as long as you have the resources to do it. Now, what we're trying to do is we then, in our system, we compact these services as much as possible to maximize the resource utilization within the system. But of course, if you've got a finite system, then you're going to have, you're going to reach a limit at a particular point. You might also reasonably see that somebody says, if possible, do this as fast as possible. And if not, what you might do is you might get you might end up deploying the service on a different set of resources, with a different quality of service, at a lower cost. So it might be better for me to get the job done today rather than getting it done today as quickly as possible. You see what I mean? So there's a whole business model that can be imposed on top of this as well. And I'll refer to that again in a few minutes. Thank you. Does that answer your question? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we then have, in the gateway, we have a blueprint with a reduced set of implementation possibilities filtered based on those quality of service requirements. Now, this is where things get a little bit interesting. These set of possibilities, this blueprint, then is pulled apart and is sent into the cell manager. To us, the cell manager is the top the top of the pyramid for the cloud. It's a cell for us is a collection of resources organized in this hierarchical fashion with intervening managers. And at the topmost level, the cell manager sees different types of resources available to it. So it may see, for example, down here I've got a CPU, but that CPU is being managed by OpenStack. Over here I've got a CPU, but it's being managed by Mesos. So we see that as different resources. We might have over here, we might have a CPU-GPU pair, and it's being managed by Mesos, and we can create containers using Marathon and Docker and that type of thing. So we partition the different types of resources at this level. You'd also see here there's an SI colon. SI here stands for suitability index, and a number. The suitability index, I like to visualize it like this. You're standing in the cell manager, and you're looking out at the resources, and what I see is I see bright lights coming at me, right? So if I see a very bright light, this is the place I should go. This is where this resource should go to, because that place is more suitable to execute me than anywhere else. Yeah? And as I go through that light might dim a little bit because now that region is not suitable anymore for the next resource request coming in, and that might go somewhere else. So we have these suitability indices, which you'll see that they're a combination of a perspective of what's happening below, combined using a very specialized mathematical function, with weights that are being propagated from the top. I'll talk about this later on. When these weights reach the bottom, these weights change how these resources are perceived, and that can feed into the business model of the CSP. I'll come back to that in a moment. So these suitability indexes then allow us to make decisions at this point without reservation. So we can say, this task can go there, it's most suitable to go there, put it there. There are intervening layers through which suitability indices from the lower fabric are propagated up. Weights are being propagated down. In fact, what's happening is propagated up here is a thing called a perspective. A weight is propagated down, and together these perspective and perspective and weights are combined to create a suitability index, which is then propagated up. At the lowest level then, we've got the resource fabric, and that resource that service will then travel to the appropriate resource where it will be housed or hosted, and then those resources are dynamically connected together through the network interconnect to reflect the blueprint combination. And indeed here, this service could be, as I said, it could be a parallel program in itself. So here, at this point, we could actually be reserving quite a number of cores to execute that that service of the group. So if I take that a little bit further then, in the architecture overview, what we have is we got this gateway, we got the cell manager, you just saw there. We then have, at the lowest level, we've got our physical resource fabric, and then those have associated managers. They're partitioned, the resource fabric is partitioned, so that it's into manageable chunks. They're also partitioned by different kinds of hardware. So different kinds of hardware, and by manageable chunks of resources of that kind. And then those are associated with each other, or associated with a manager, and then managers are associated with managers at a higher level, etc. And this, the depth of this here really can be variable. We thought we only need two layers to reflect what we need. So we'll move on. Oh, sorry. That's probably enough. This is probably more detail than I will go into in the time I have, because I don't have, I'm conscious of not using all of your time. But we have the ability in this system, at the lowest level, to identify resources of different types. We may have a manager that's managing specialized hardware, HPC hardware. We might be a manager that's managing servers that of a particular kind. We might have a manager that's managing servers on a dedicated high-speed, low-latency interconnect. And when we're registering this cluster with the system, that information is retained. So the fact that these servers, these specific servers, are sitting on a low-latency interconnect is remembered at that point, that that type of manager then effectively says, I can do jobs of this kind. So there's a suitability index associated with that, and jobs that need to be allocated to low latency clusters. That's not something that you see readily in the cloud, because again, everything in the homogeneous cloud says the resource fabric is homogeneous, everything is as far away from everything else. It's isotropic, essentially. But here, we're saying even the resource, the interconnect fabric, it's all homogeneous. And we remember that information, we can do these allocations to them. Now, the reason that these are important is that these types of, I said I wasn't going to explain this, now I'm explaining it. These different types of resources can cooperate in particular ways. But there are certain type A won't necessarily be able to cooperate with type B. But two types A could cooperate together, two types C could cooperate together, type C and type A could conceivably cooperate together, etc. So we can form these coalitions, which allow these, which says, for example, that this manager may take over the management of those resources. Understand? Now, why is that important? Well, this is down to our self-organization. When we see a task coming down, remember there's no reservation, a task comes into the system, it follows the traffic lights, I'm going to the most suitable place. Then it arrives somewhere and says, oh, conceivably there's enough resources down here to host me, but they're fragmented. Yeah? It's an aspect of the suitability index that says, what is my capacity down here? But it doesn't capture, because it's a single number, it doesn't capture any fragmentation. So it is possible that a resource comes to a location in the cloud, and in aggregate, there's enough resources to support that service, I mean, but they're not co-located, or it's not compacted to support the service directly. So what happens is, at that point, rather than reject the task, is we go through a reorganization step. So the certain resources will be exchanged between managers. So now really what happens is that just the identifier of one resource is now being managed by a different manager. So it could be possible that a neighbor will say, you can manage my resource here to get you out of the bind, you can allocate your task on this resource, then you do the local management. That updates your suitability index, and things are reflected differently there. So we use self-organization to get us out of a bind, when the suitability index fails at a particular point. And that has, you'll see from our results, has reduced our rejection rate to almost nothing within the system at scale. Okay, I mentioned this. So what we have then, we have a hierarchical, I'll show you the hierarchy that we created in a moment. We have a hierarchical cloud. At the bottom, we have a resource fabric. In the VNE layers, we've got some managers, and we've got the single cell manager at the very top. Associated with on the underlying resources, we have specific functions that determine certain things. For example, we might have a function that determines the energy that that resource is using. We might have a function that determines the management cost of that resource at that level. We might have a function that determines the computational power of that resource at that level. And there's a fourth one, which is the management cost. Well, no, I've already said that. There's a fourth one. I forget what it is. Okay, you'll think of it as well. We're up since five. So we have those management functions, or these assessment functions, saying really how these resources are behaving or are performing in those dimensions at that level. The thing is, and that saves to the telemetry, the thing is that those values of those assessment functions are combined to create the suitability index. However, at the same time, we have weights that can be propagated from the cell down. And as these weights move down through the system, they can be changed, they can be attenuated, they can be augmented, depending on what strategy we want to implement at different parts of the cloud. And these weights, ultimately, they become associated with a particular point in the hierarchy to create a suitability index. So this is effect like an impetus forcing the cloud to reflect the particular suitability that is determined by the weight that's being propagated down and the metric that's being generated by the low-level function. So, for example, particular nodes here could be saying, we are this much energy efficient, propagate that up. The cloud provider could say, I don't really care about energy efficiency. Because if I worry about energy efficiency, I'm going to lose QoS and somewhere else. That's not my business model. So it might propagate down a weight that then becomes associated with that function. It's a weighted assessment function. And that weight could be zero, or could be a zero. So you multiply that zero by that function, and the calculation of the energy, or the contribution of the calculation of the energy to the suitability index is nullified, is removed. You see? So in that way we have what's called a directed evolution. So whereas the business logic of the cloud provider can determine how he wants the cloud to respond to in different axes, energy, management, computability, all of these things. And we think that's very powerful. And that creates the suitability index, again, then determining where things should be sent. We augmented the architecture then that I showed you here to introduce these various levels to allow that to happen. Effectively, that's it. I'm not going to go into that story too much more. Here's this, a kind of, a picture showing what I just said. So the cell manager will send weights to the P router, to the P switch. These are known as prescriptions. We say that the service request coming in is a prescription. And then eventually it arrives at what's called a virtual rack manager. This virtual rack manager is the lowest level manager managing the specific resources. And then with each of these resources, these are these assessment functions. These resources are feed into these assessment functions. These are weighted assessment functions, determining these metrics, determining the at each level the suitability index. So you can see that we have a very, very flexible framework then that allows us to change the way the system behaves over time. And indeed, the propagation of those weights can actually be delayed. You can introduce kind of a hysteresis into the system. That means that by changing a weight, you're not introducing an automatic perturbation and causing the cloud to jump all over the place. There can be a slow transition or evolution towards a particular business model. And we see that as being extremely important. And the local goal of every point in the cloud then is to maximize the suitability index. So every point of the cloud has a suitability index, and the local goal is to maximize its suitability index. That's what every part of the cloud tries to do. Understand? So therefore, and the suitability index essentially is a description of how suitable am I to accept the next task of a particular client. I put this in just for completeness as kind of our full cartoon of our full system. So we've got services that are pre-built by experts. Remember, Blueprint is a service. We've done this around our use cases, the oil and gas genomics and ray tracing. These then can be extracted, these services can be extracted and composed by a blueprint creator. The blueprint creator then creates the blueprint catalog. The operator can extract the catalog, can associate some quality of service metrics with them, can then send it to the gateway. The service then is deployed in the underlying resources. The telemetry is used to monitor the health of that application, and then a deployed application then can interact directly with the end user. And then we have this other trajectory where new resources can be plugged into the cloud. It looks very grid-like, but it's not grid-like because we don't see these resources coming and going as dynamically as they do in the grid. But we wanted a mechanism that allowed the cloud to evolve as new hardware became available. And the clouds are always evolving, right? Clouds are always, the hardware is always being refreshed. In fact, one interesting thing is because we partition our cloud, you could say, I want to take that partition down for maintenance. So what you could do is you can inject, or you could interject at some point and say, set the suitability index to zero at that point. Then no tasks will go to that part of the cloud anymore. When all the tasks are finished in that part of the cloud, nothing will come in. You could take the cloud down, you could take that partition down, you can maintain it and then bring it back up again. So you can wind the cloud out, you can wind the cloud up, you can evolve the cloud. It's very natural like that, right? Okay, onto the simulation results. This is what you're probably interested in. I won't go into the details of the simulator here. Gabrielle is an expert in simulation, the PhD is in simulation, he knows this stuff backwards. We created a new simulator that's not a discrete event simulator, it's a time advancing loop simulator. It's more physics modeling type of an approach. It's written in C and C++ with MPI and OpenMP. So it's actually very fast, and it's a HPC application in itself. And it was run on an open HPC environment that our Greek colleagues have access to. We simulated 13 cells containing this many CPUs, this many CPU GPUs, this many CPU many integrated cores, this many CPU DFEs. DFE is a data flow engine based on a field programmable gate array, giving us a total of 1.3 million servers. We had a network bandwidth of 20 gigabits per second, 100 servers per VRAC manager at the lowest level, so that's very manageable. We had 10 VRAC managers per switch. So you can, if you do the maths, you'll find out that you have 250 switches or something, and then it was 4 P routers. They're thereabouts. This just indicates the distribution of our tasks. We have 5 different task types. So we have 3 use cases, but 2 of those use cases had multiple implementations. So we had genomics running on DFEs, we had genomics running on CPUs, we had oil and gas running on GPUs, and oil and gas running on CPUs, and we had I don't know what's included here, but we had ray tracing running on the NICs and ray tracing on GPUs or CPUs alone. And this was the distribution of the number of tasks that we have here by 10 to the power of 4, and the number of instructions that were required by each one of them, which was 5 millions of instructions. Well, no, so that's 5 there. It's million of instructions to the power of 7. So 7 million of instructions to the power of 7. That's basically the axis. Just let me skip over. These are the things we were measuring. Total energy consumption, total number of accepted tasks, rejected tasks, the average processor utilization, the average processor utilization for active servers, etc. So we can measure quite a lot of things. We have actually the simulator here. We could, on a one-to-one basis, show you the type of things that we're measuring. So some of the results. This is the traditional cloud versus the self-organizing, self-managing cloud. Now, when I saw the traditional cloud here, I must own up a little bit. We're looking at traditional, thank you very much, traditional resource, a very simple resource allocation strategy, which is a first fit. So when the task comes in, the cloud, the centralized system says, where is the first place I can put this task so that it'll actually work, and then dump it. So that's fast, but it isn't very intelligent. Okay. Now, but to have some element of comparison, well, we implement the same first fit strategy, but after following the suitability index. So the task comes in, we follow the suitability index to what we think is the most appropriate place, and then the first fit in that place. Okay? So it's a reasonable thing to do. You'll see that the energy consumption for the traditional system is a lot higher up to this point, and I'll describe that point in a moment, than our system. Why is that? Because we got better placement, we got faster placement, and we get more efficient placement on the accelerators. At this point, they seem to converge. But on further investigation, what we found at that point, which is around 320 tasks per second entering the system, we found that the rejection rate of the traditional system started to skyrocket. It could not find a best fit in the cloud of that size at that incoming rate. Whereas we kept the number of accepted tasks. The rejected is there. So they started rejecting tasks like Billio. We reject nothing, and our accepted tasks increase. Now that is telling us that we're using the cloud better. Okay, these are very high. I apologize for running through these numbers. I'm happy to go through the graphs into more details in the graphs with you. Here the number of rejected tasks. This is 1,800 at the top here for the traditional cloud, with 320 incoming tasks per second. You can see the rejection rate here has gone up to about 1,400. And then up here to 1,800 tasks. Here at 640 incoming tasks per second, the traditional cloud, this number here is 400,000. So there's 400,000 tasks being rejected. And for the SOSIM system, this number is 20. And this number is 30, this number is 35. Not 1,000, just 35. So you can see the number of tasks that we were rejecting at that rate of utilization into the cloud was phenomenally less than the traditional simple first fit. Why? Because we were able to compact better, following the suitability index, we were compacting better. It was still first fit at the lowest level, but we weren't throwing tasks just anywhere, randomly, right? And as a result, energy benefits showed as well, because we could keep servers in idle mode until they were actually needed. The thing about a server is that it's not power proportional. If it's an idle, it's using 20% of its overall energy. You put one task on this there, it's gone up to 80%. No matter what the utilization is, it's going from 20 to 80. So if you start randomly throwing tasks at a server and you start scattering them around the place, your energy is coming up. Yeah? Whereas our energy is coming up a lot slower because our utilization is a lot better. The average process utilization of overactive servers, again, we can see here the traditional utilization is 70%, ours is only 40% for the same number of tasks. So we were compacting better. That's basically what I'm saying. The average accelerator utilization, we're utilizing 35% of the accelerators. The traditional cloud, which was random nature, was struggling to reach 12%. So again, the placement strategy, even with a first fit at the lowest level, through the suitability index, self-management, was giving us these results. Again, there's more of the same here, and in fact, you can see that we're kind of better in a lot of indices, and I won't go through all of those because of the time. But again, it's to do with the average accelerator utilization of the active servers for different situations. We then actually improved our system as well, and we were able to find that our energy consumption of our system over a particular level was improved, got better. It looks here as if we're using more energy. But in the traditional system at that scale, what was happening is that there's a huge number of rejection of tasks. So therefore, a lot of energy is, or less energy is being used because nothing has been done.
Are you measuring energy on the server, or are you measuring energy on the task?
Are we measuring energy on the server or per task?
It's per server. It's per server. Because at the end, you can go to measuring in the simulator the energy per task, but what you're interested is in knowing how much energy your data center is consuming at the end.
Yeah, but sometimes people look at the how much tasks they're actually using as well, and then they do like a analysis. So it's like, I know this task takes about, I would say, 80% of energy. This task is going to run, but it's going to take 20% energy, so I can stack them on the same server.
Yeah, you're fully right, but for this experiments, what we aimed was to evaluate the system from the perspective of the data center, the improvement of all the cloud lining system as a stack in managing all the resources, more than focus in a concrete task. So, but it's possible to do that with the simulator. So,
I'm conscious of your time, so I just run some. So I skipped a number of things here, which were basically synthetic simulation inputs. We had a number of different tasks, and we were just looking at seeing if this, using synthetic inputs, would give us the similar results, and they do. The concluding remarks here: Cloud Lightning is a system for managing heterogeneity. I think that's a big thing that we want to get out of here at all scales. The heterogeneity can mean the physical resources. It can mean the resource abstraction method, the containers, the VMs. It can be in the resource managers themselves, the OpenStack, Mesos, etc. The use of suitability index eliminates the need for reservation within the in the co-allocation of resources to host services of a blueprint. That means that the time to service deployment is drastically reduced, because and the reservation in a traditional system, if you reserve a resource, that resource is basically not up for allocation by something else. Even though you might come along a couple of minutes later and unreserve it again. So there's also the utilization associated with that activity. The weightings applied to the assessment functions essentially determine the characteristics of the evolving cloud. This directed evolution can be used to reflect the business priorities of the CSP, as I said. The social system evolves to optimize, as reflected by the weighted assessment functions, the use of the cloud for the profile of the services being processed over time. So typically we see that we have a service profile coming into the cloud, and the cloud will reorganize itself to optimize itself for servicing that profile of services. Yeah? If you change your service profile, the cloud will reorganize itself to optimize for the new service profile. That's a very interesting thing that we recognized and we identified from our simulations. The complexity for deploying and managing the heterogeneous workflow is addressed by the system rather than by the application creator. That's the blueprint as a service. So that gives us the democratization, I suppose, of HPC in the cloud. It allows people to use HPC in the cloud more easily. I think that's important because it goes to the ease of use. Simulation results can show potential over some potential improvements for all aspects of resource utilization. We're only careful about making definitive statements, but all I can show you the trends in our graphs and give you the context in which they were created. I'm saying that it delivers advantages at all scales. The self-organization kicks in at scale when you find that you go to a particular place and you don't have the resources in aggregate to satisfy the service. Self-organization kicks in. But typically the system lives most of its life in self-management. There's again just some of the SOSIM is able to serve 52% of the for 100 cells more tasks than the traditional system, utilize 57% more accelerators than the traditional system in that allocation scheme. And when we improved the system, we actually even got a 6% improvement over our own system when we improved our assessment functions for energy. Just some final remarks then. As the cloud, I suppose, evolves, centralized management will become less effective and may not be fit for purpose. This is what I think is a conclusion. It was also a suspicion when we started. Self-organization and self-management offer an alternative resource management strategy. I think our results show that. It's scalable to meet the needs of the complex cloud environment. Complex in terms of heterogeneity, different types of users, different types of heterogeneity at all levels. Some design objectives and principles have been proposed to initiate this, so we have a kind of an initial architecture proposal how you would actually embody this principle within this architecture. But I must say, it's not without its issues. Self-organization is not a panacea. By embracing complexity, and what we're doing, we're ceding explicit control and a loss of system knowledge. And that can be unnerving. It's inevitable because it's unnerving. When you make some things self-organizing, we can monitor. But typically, when we monitor, we see what happened in the recent past. We can predict where things are going, but it may not be possible to see if something is going to go pathological. Yeah, and it is possible that a system that is self-organized can, at a particular point, go pathological. However, in all the experiments that we've run, we haven't observed any pathological.
We're working on John's communication of risk.
No, but it's important to actually point that out. But what I'm saying is we haven't observed anything like that. But it is an inherent criticism of self-organization. But I think self-organization, together with careful monitoring, together with machine learning, I think any pathological behavior, I think, is probably a far remote possibility. Thank you, and sorry for keeping you so long. Thank you.